Joanna Lumley, welcome.
Thank you so much, Fredrik.
Tell me, as you are here with a former monk in this show tonight, you're not a stranger to Buddhism, are you?
It was really my grandfather who was a diplomat, and in his duties he was in Persia, but also he was in Bhutan and Sikkim and Tibet. And while he was in Tibet, as quite a young man, he made friends with the 13th Dalai Lama and became quite an expert on Tibetan Buddhism, and then brought back and was given all kinds of treasures, teapots and tankas and all kinds of things from Tibet, which have remained so precious to my family. And then I've been lucky enough in my lifetime to have met His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama several times.
So when you go to visit the Dalai Lama,
yeah,
what do you bring? Do you bring a bottle of wine, or what do you bring?
What can you give to somebody who is a living god and who's in exile in Dharamsala and who is followed by so many millions throughout the world, whether they are Buddhists or not, who have nothing but his goodwill at heart, and is followed by a retinue of monks? And we thought, up on his high land, how can he ever see how many people are queuing to see him? So I gave him a drone. And one of the young monks learned how to operate the drone, and His Holiness was very pleased. And when I gave it to him, you know how he speaks, he said, "Oh, so it won't hit me in the head." We said, "No, Holiness, it will not. It will fly beautifully and just observe the beautiful hills around you."
You are famous for your good mood. I mean, you have a great mood, people say that know you. And I'm not sure, is that something that you can learn, or is that something you were born with?
Well, I think I was born with it. When I was born, my father said I didn't have a nose, I just had two holes pushed in my face, but my mouth was like the hammer-headed shark. It went all around my head, and already I was smiling when I was born. So I think I was born with a happy, optimistic disposition. But we all get times when the world seems to get on top of us, or the black dog sits on our shoulder, we become depressed and can't really see a way forward. And I think to a certain extent, you have to train yourself little tricks, little steps, the way that you can get out of it, small ways of sorting out your fear or despair or darkness. And I've got all sorts of things up my sleeve for when I can feel that feeling of, I don't know, just inadequacy or disappointment and lack of energy and lack of happiness, is to just a few little steps, which I shan't bore you with now, Frederick, because I can see by your gorgeous face that you're not remotely depressed. Don't need me going on about it now. But you have to work out ways, Björn, I think I'm right about this, of seeing yourself in the world.
I think we all need this. What is it? Keep it short. You can do it.
Well, one of the small things is to smile at people immediately. Go out on the street and smile at people, because when somebody smiles back to you, it is simply electrifying what happens. It's like being given a great bunch of flowers. Fairly normal things. It doesn't need money. It doesn't need money.
When in your life did you have a black dog on your shoulder?
Oh, it comes back every now and then, not a really bad one. I'm not a real depressive, but we all have times when you just feel, sometimes it's when you're tired. So recognize what's going on and just diffuse the bombs as they're laid in your path. Diffuse them.
Talking about diffusing bombs, you were a Bond girl early in your career.
I was, and I was actually trained to be an angel of death by the dreaded Blofeld, and we were to go back to our countries and spread the disease around the world so Blofeld could become the ultimate master. Look, I only had two lines in it, but it was one of the most exciting things in the world. It was about the second film I'd ever done. The first one, I had one line, which was, "Yes, Mr. Robinson." But in the Bond film, I had two whole lines, and I was on it for a month.
What were they? Can you remember them?
Yes, James Bond had come up to Blofeld's mountain lair in Switzerland, and he was wearing a kilt.
And this was George Lazenby, right?
This was George Lazenby. He was posing as a Scotsman, and he was wearing a kilt. And all the girls were very suspicious. They thought a man who wears a dress is not a full man. And so my character had to say, "I know what he's allergic to." So that was my one line. Very exciting. I can remember it now. And the next one was when we were about to be dispatched from the mountaintop, and it was Christmas time, and we were all dressed in our going-away outfits and given presents. and a tray of drinks. Irma Bundt gave them out, the brilliant Ilse Steppart. She said, have a drink, some eggnog. And I had to say, oh, eggnog, how lovely, just like we have at home. Well, I mean, I was so bad, but I couldn't have loved it more.
I think you delivered them perfectly. It's amazing.
Thank you. Thank you.
But the thing is, I read on the internet recently, and you can confirm or deny here, but you've said that you've kissed every one of the James Bond actors.
Not in a horrible, schmoozy way. Yes, it's completely possible, Frederick. When you're as old as I am, you tend to do quite a lot of kissing. But what I mean is that not on screen. I didn't kiss any of them on screen, or even romantically. Not even romantically, but we've all turned up at different times doing things, sometimes doing a charity show for something. Sometimes with Roger Moore, I was in a Pink Panther film with him. Sean Connery, I just knew anyway. Daniel Craig, I've been there at award ceremonies when he was there and we just kissed in the way that... So it's only kissy-kissy, Pierce Brosnan, Tim Dalton, who I knew as a friend. And so all kinds of people, I've just... Mwah, mwah. But I've kissed them all. And I've kissed DiCaprio as well.
Not many people have.
No, they can't.
Tell me, you knew Sean Connery quite well, and he passed away recently. How do you remember him?
He was an extraordinary man. For a start, he was devastatingly attractive. I mean, it's quite difficult to explain what he was like in the flesh. I think rather like Elvis Presley, people were just taken aback by what an impact seeing Sean Connery had. He was tall, he was amazingly good-looking, and he had a kind of charm which seemed to ooze out of him. He had a sense of maybe being abrupt or slightly scowly. Not really, because he was charming, but he looked a little bit Bondish and threatening. And I think everybody was so thrilled to see that after Bond, his role as an actor really just soared. So the skill to hold down the character of Bond is brilliant. But the other roles he did showed that he was really a tremendous actor and a comedian, a very good light comedian, but a dark, deep actor as well. Much missed, but he lived a full and tremendous life.
How many of the James Bond actors do you think would have survived the Me Too era?
The later ones would. The early ones, nobody would have survived the Me Too era, nobody. Because in those days, girls were always eye candy. We were always dressed up like mad. And even though you might be with a much older man who wasn't necessarily a good looker, you always had to be good looking. They used to, in the very early days, girls, to show a group of girls together, they were always giggling. So girls always tittered like that. And they would run in sort of soppy ways and they had to have quite low-cut dresses and wear lip gloss and everything. They were never allowed to be real characters. So all my life I was searching for any part that would take me, having been a model and therefore always being put in the category of a pretty girl, but longing to have comedy or drama or something different to get my teeth into.
Yeah, you certainly got a hit at the fashion industry, I would say, with Absolutely Fabulous and your character Patsy, which we saw a clip from here. And I wonder how close to home was that? Coming from the fashion industry having been a model, how close to home was Patsy?
Well, Jennifer Saunders, who not only starred in the show but wrote it as well, is extremely generous. And so she said to me, what do you think Patsy's like? What do you think she was? And I said, oh, if she was a model, I can make that part of it because I can remember modelling in the 60s. I know exactly what it would have been like. Patsy was miles older than me, I think. Nobody knows. She could have been 80. We don't know how old she was. We know that when she came to go to school with Edina, that Patsy was about 13 and had to get into little tiny chairs. She'd never been taught anything. She was born in France and she was just Eurotrash, really. I don't think I've ever enjoyed playing a part more than that. She was so ghastly. They were so terrible. But it was very, very funny. And the fashion industry adored it. They loved having the fun made of them about their obsession with clothes or styles or people who are in and people who are out and fashion shows and photo shoots. And Patsy had a job as some kind of fashion editor. She had never done a day's work in her life. She didn't even know where her office was. So these were heavenly people to play, heavenly. And she's not like me. I drink a bit, I smoke a bit, but Patsy would wake up with a cigarette in her lips. She couldn't live without her bottles of vodka mixed with champagne, you know? And all her organs had been removed because they were all rotted away, so she had nothing inside her. So sometimes she just had a tube, and when she drank, it just ran out of the other end.
It's been a while now since you did her. I feel I can miss her already. Do you miss her?
Jennifer and I, whenever we're together, we can't forget them. It's like the creaking lid of an old vampire woman. Out we come again. We emerge fully formed. And remember, Frederick, we've done in our shows, we've shown them when they were very old, little bald, sparse hair, when they were completely dotty and Patsy's pants falling down. I mean, we've seen them so old and decrepit, but they're never dead. So I have a feeling they will never die. Never.
In Sweden and Norway, you are quite well now well known these days for your traveling shows, and you've done quite many, and we can watch them here. I can see that sometimes you travel quite rough. I mean, it's not luxurious all the time, or is just that just for the camera?
No, it's not just for the camera. And also, it's quite a lot rougher than you see, because quite often you're sleeping for 12 hours on the floor of some airport in the middle of Africa, but we don't film all that. You can't film everything like that. Tough time once in the Nubian desert in Africa in a little orange tent doing my makeup by torchlight, which is why I sometimes look a bit over made up, because you're shining a torch in the mirror and trying to do this, sleeping on the ground, shaking your boots out. And, you know, sometimes it's quite tough. Other times, of course, a beautiful hotel or in Japan, lying on a flat floor, and wondering how you'll ever get to sleep with your elbows and hips and things like this. But I love that, you know, because I'm quite outdoorsy, and I like the idea of hiking, and I don't mind getting wet or dirty or wading through a river up to my chest, you know, it's okay.
When you travel, what's the policy on phoning home? How much do you talk to your husband?
Very little. I think phoning home is beastly. I write emails. Because for a start, quite often the time zone is wrong. And there's nothing worse than phoning up when you've had a gin and tonic in the evening and it's the morning with them and they're putting the dustbins out and you're going, hello, how are you? It doesn't work.
So, I mean, you managed to stay, unlike Patsy, you managed to stay married for many, many years. Mm-hmm. So would you say, apart from not phoning home from travels, what would you say is the secret behind a long, long marriage? I'm going to ask you as well.
Yeah. Well, I think, important thing, you've got to like them as well as love them. So if you like them, they're a proper true friend, your best friend. You must respect them. You must think that they're pretty marvellous. And I do. I can do that effortlessly. My husband is a musician and I'm in awe of him. You must love being with them and you must not mind being without them. You mustn't be suspicious. They must be free. If you let people free, they come back. And that's the same with me. He waves me goodbye on these long trips. And so I think of nobody but him.
How about you, Magdalena?
I agree to be free, to have, but at the same time, also to have a common interest, to have a common goal, for example. I think that's also important.
Yeah.
What would that be for you and your husband?
Well, our common goal is our farm, to settle down on our farm. That's going to be in the future.
And what about you, Björn? What's the secret behind the long marriage?
Ooh, like Joanna said, respect goes a pretty long way. To not stop seeing what you saw in your partner from the beginning. Mm. And when you live with somebody for a long time, it's easy to start having opinions about their not so wonderful traits. So keep noticing the wonderful things about them. Keep reminding yourself. And then there's something about the modern myth of love where it seems like it's easy to start demanding that this person makes you happy. That's not fair. It's nobody else's job to make you happy. It's your job. It's my job to make me happy. So I noticed that the less I demand that my wife make me happy, the more happy she makes me. Yes.
Wise, well, that's the takeaway, isn't it? Isn't that lovely? I feel, thank you, Magdalena, thank you, Björn, because you've made me much better than I am already. Just being with you has made me better.
How is that possible?
Oh, Frederick.
Thank you so much, Joanna. Thank you very much.
It's been lovely. Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.